Well, Bob, what Mark Martin's team did last weekend was perhaps within the spirit of the rules, but outside the letter of the rules. And the letter of the rules says you cannot bolt on any bigger than a 2-inch spacer. Martin's group argues, however, that these spacers have been welded on to intake manifolds, and spacers bigger than 2 inches had been welded on. If they'd done that, it would have been just fine. This is an intake manifold that has had a spacer welded onto it. It's identical in configuration to the manifold they had on the car last week, except this one's welded, theirs was bolted, and this is the same size, same shape manifold they have on the car today, and it has passed inspection.
Mark Martin is one of the most respected drivers inside and outside of the NASCAR garage. He's respected for more than just being a NASCAR Hall of Famer or being recognized as one of the 50 greatest drivers, and again as one of the 75 greatest drivers. A lot of his respect comes from how he carried himself on and off the track. He's everything a race car driver should be. Whenever there is a discussion about his Cup career, at some point the topic of championships will be mentioned along with the phrase, best driver that never won a championship, having finished second in points 5 times, 1990, 1994, 1998, 2002, and 2009. Many focus on that first second place finish in 1990, where Mark Martin would finish 26 points behind Dale Earnhardt. And you can't talk about that without mentioning the 46-point deduction Mark received during that season. Why? Let's go to the UPI archives. Richmond, Virginia. Mark Martin captured NASCAR's 458,000 Pontiac Excitement 400 Sunday with just a second to spare, but his victory was tainted when race inspectors fined him $40,000 for using an illegal engine part, the largest fine in stock car racing history. Martin's victory was allowed to stand, but he was docked 46 champion points and was forced to turn over more than two-thirds of his winnings. NASCAR competition director Dick Beatty said the victory would not count toward a lucrative winner's circle championship. The engine in Martin's Ford was fitted with a 2.5-inch carburetor spacer. Although NASCAR allows spacers for no more than 2 inches, Beatty said he didn't know if the spacer gave the engine more power. However, one rival team owner said the spacer enables the engine to take in more air and thus generate more horsepower. Seems fairly cut and dry, but what is more intriguing, the nexus for this penalty may have begun long before that cold February day at Richmond. Let's set the stage going into 1990. Mark Martin is driving for Jack Roush and Roush Racing. Robin Pemberton is his crew chief, and Steve Mill is the team manager. Jack Roush, known as the Cat in the Hat, would be starting his third full season in Cup. He entered NASCAR with quite a bit of a resume, having won championships in Trans Am and IMSA. He also had built up a great relationship with Ford going back to the 1960s, so the expectation was he would win a championship in Cup sooner rather than later. Also, how often do you see a section on someone's Wikipedia page, with exception of maybe a test pilot or Harrison Ford, that states, plane crashes, plural, as in more than one. Jack Roush has survived 2 plane crashes. I guess the Cat in the Hat has 9 lives. Wow. That joke is horrible. JoJo, when you edit this, be sure to cut out that joke. That was just, yeah. And fire whoever wrote that. I wrote it. Robin Pemberton came to Roush Racing in 1987, having worked with Petty Enterprises since 1979. Joining him was Steve Mill. The two of them had been friends for years. Jack Roush would task them with building his Cup team. Mark Martin had already been in the Cup Series since 1981, having driven for 8 different teams, but only completed 1 full season in 1982. From 1981 through 1987, Mark ran 57 Cup races, with no wins, 4 top fives. What caught the eye of Jack Roush was his success in the Busch Series during the 1987 season, where Mark won 3 times. Jack would hire Mark to drive for his Cup team in 1988. This was supposed to be a partial schedule. And to everyone's surprise, just a couple of months before the season was to start, Jack would announce at a press conference on his shop floor that 1988, they would be running a full season. This came as a real shock to Steve Mill, and especially Robin Pemberton, who was working on a fuel cell in the trunk of a car when he heard Jack say this to the reporters nearby, causing him to raise up and bang his head on the deck lid.
We are running the full schedule in 1988.
What the hell did he just say?
Shazma. Only a couple months away from Daytona, and they only had 2 cars. But this would be a common thing among Jack, Robin, or Steve, where one does something the other two are completely unaware of. 1988 was about what you'd expect for a first-year team. They did have 2 top fives and a second-place finish at Bristol. When I think of 1989, It's Rusty Wallace versus Dale Earnhardt for the championship, and Mark Martin winning his first race.
Coming out of corner number four, Mark Martin receives the white flag. There is one more lap to go, one more tour of the 1.017-mile oval at Rockingham, North Carolina, and Mark Martin, 30-year-old driver from Batesville, Arkansas, driver of the Strohlite Ford, will win his first Winston Cup event. Here he is, moving through turns number three and four. He sees the checkered flag ahead in the hands of Harold Kinder. He receives the checkered flag. Mark Martin wins!
What I forget, what never gets mentioned, was the fact that going into the last race of the season at Atlanta, Mark Martin was second in points, only 78 behind Rusty Wallace. That's right, he was second in points going into the last race with a legit chance to win the championship. But a blown engine would relegate him to a 30th place finish, dropping him to third in points to finish the 1989 season. This is amazing. In just their second season, Roush Racing and the number 6 car were contenders for the championship. This would not go unnoticed, as the competitors now viewed them as a serious threat. Now into the 1990 Daytona 500, and one of the seeds planted that would come back to haunt the number 6 car. It began with inspection issues on the number 6 car. Steve Mill was shocked when the template was several inches off when measuring the roof. He had no idea how this happened. The car was well within the regulations at the shop. Steve would relay this to Jack Roush, which began his irritation with the NASCAR inspectors.
Let's talk about the team getting failing tech for the roof being too low at Daytona, right? And so Jack sits there at the tech shed and watching everybody else get teched and goes, well, what's that? What about this, right?
Yes.
Some things that he...
That was unfortunate.
Did he do anything wrong?
Maybe the only problem was not understanding the culture.
And so that ticked off officials, teams,
yeah. Who?
The officials take offense.
Oh, no question. Buster was the guy in the template room.
Gotcha.
And at that time, they didn't have the block, you know, the red, yellow, you know. So you just kind of look at
it. It's a wooden thing.
Go on. Go on. Yeah.
Jack didn't like the fact the template fitting process came down to the judgment of one man, that man being Buster Otten. There was no electronic go, no-go light. It was all up to Buster and his eyes to give you a pass or fail on the template. So now we have a frustrated Steve Mill, a frustrated Jack Roush. Well, what they did not know is that Robin Pemberton had made some adjustments to the roof of the car, and that's why the template was so far off. Again, we have communication issues where one does something the other two were unaware of.
So we go through the templates, and they throw the overall up on the car, and I about threw up. I mean, it missed the back of the roof an inch, which is exactly opposite of what you would do, because you don't want more air attaching to the roof and going down and hitting the spoiler. You want, you know, you kind of puff the back of the roof up. And I'm like, I said, man, I swear. And Jack's like, what is that all about? And I said, Jack, I swear to you, man, it wasn't like that at the shop. I mean, and this went on for a day while we're fixing. Well, finally I heard that Robin and the guys, while I wasn't there, had lowered the back of the roof at the shop.
Not knowing this, Jack is about to take his frustration out on the inspection system. He does this by staying around to watch several other cars go through the process. He didn't just watch, but openly questioned the inspectors on why some cars got a pass based on how he viewed the template.
That Jack took the job of going and standing in Room of Doom and watching every car go through the templates. Well, that made NASCAR and Dick Beatty mad. You know, what are you doing? I'm seeing. I'm going to see what we got going. So they're nervous about us running too good. Did the wrong thing and got caught. And instead of just quietly fixing the problem, we kind of showed our butts by standing around and watching with your arms crossed.
Now, this did not sit well with the NASCAR officials or the competitors. One of the many unspoken rules in NASCAR, don't openly criticize or accuse a team of cheating. At least that was the rule back in the day. Remember that time Denny Hamlin called out RCR in the press? During practice that followed, RCR driver Kevin Harvick made it a point to send a message to Denny Hamlin.
The penalties given to Clint Boyer. After his win in last Sunday's Sprint Cup Series race in New Hampshire, his car failed a subsequent inspection at the NASCAR R&D Center on Tuesday. The body placement on the car, not where it should have been according to NASCAR specs. Boyer docked 150 driver points, which knocked him from second back to 12th in the chase. Well, naturally, when the press conferences began here at Dover on Friday, a lot of reporters were asking other competitors about the situation revolving around the Childress team.
In the garage, everyone's known it for months. It's not 2 weeks old. This is something that's been going on for months. They've been worn for a long time, way before Richmond. So this is not something that, oh man, we got, you know, they just told us halfway after Richmond and going in the loud net, our car's wrong. They knew it was wrong way before that, you know, and I felt like they just, they wanted to get everything they could. You know, what did they have to lose, really? So, you know, you almost can't fault them for that.
Flash forward to Saturday morning's practice. Kevin Harvick, one of the Childress drivers, follows Denny Hamlin out onto the racetrack and basically appears to be trying to send a message.
He is upset.
I don't like what you said, I think, was the message. A little contact, a little more contact, a little more contact out on the racetrack. Both drivers called off the track by NASCAR into the garage where discussion ensued.
Boys having a little bit of a heated debate on territory there. And, you know, it's very difficult when you're making the implication that someone else is cheating. It goes to the core. And what happened in this incident, as we saw with the final.
And to modernize this to 2023 standards, keep my team's name out your mouth.
If you want to pull an inspector to the side or tell them in private you think another team is cheating or hold a private meeting in the NASCAR hauler, that is perfectly acceptable. Just don't do it in public. Now we jump to Richmond, race number two of the 1990 season.
In front, and Earnhardt is closing. Now Earnhardt begins to draw him up.
1 12 100 seconds separate the leader from his nearest pursuer, Dale Earnhardt.
Off turn two, Martin gets a jump and he pulls away again. There you see the interval between first and second place men. Car number three, Earnhardt in second. There's that leader out of turn four, and here comes in hot pursuit Dale Earnhardt and Ricky Rudd.
1 6 100 seconds. Earnhardt closed by 6 100ths of a second that last time around.
Elliott's fourth, Dick Trickle fifth. Wallace falling back after he and Earnhardt were in contact. Seventh is Morgan Shepherd. Eighth is Rick Bodine. Ninth, Jimmy Spencer. Tenth, Ken Schrader. Laps running down. Mark Martin, who won his first Winston Cup race, Rockingham, North Carolina, at the Rock a year ago. Actually, this past November. Here he is looking for win number two. And here's that second place man, number three, Earnhardt, still trying to close it up.
As Mark crosses the start finish right this time, he'll get the two laps to go signal. And here comes Earnhardt.
Earnhardt still closing up here at the finish. He fell back, and turn number two seems to be his Achilles heel. Down for the finish this afternoon. White flag next time around for the leader. And it is the Ford being driven by Mark Martin out of Arkansas that is staying up in front. Everybody harkens back to just a week ago when it looked like Earnhardt had it all locked up. And then, last corner, last lap, Dale Earnhardt had to settle out of the win place and show. Final lap here, the Pontiac Excitement 400. Mark Martin striving. He's been the strong car in the final day of practice yesterday. He's coming to the line. He is the strongest car of the day.
Mark Martin has won the second race of his career. All is well. Or is it?
Oh, my.
During the post-race teardown of the number six car, in walks Richard Childress, owner of the number three car, driven by Dale Earnhardt, who had just finished second. Richard has an inspector with him.
Go to Victory Lane. It's freezing cold. And get done with that, shove the car down in the garage, and we pull the hood open. And Richard Childress came by on this side, and he went, "It's right there." And I'm like, I didn't even know it was right there. I mean, I didn't know what he was talking about.
What Steve did not know was that going back to the previous season, Jack was hounding Robin Pemberton about how the carburetor lined up with the cowl. Robin set out to solve this issue.
As it turns out, and Jack was always nervous about our drag because we were more than happy to trade drag for downforce. And at Richmond, did it really make any difference? I don't know. But Jack was always on Robin as the crew chief to make sure the cowl lined up perfectly, base of the cowl lined up perfectly with the car bottom of the air cleaner.
Yeah.
Okay. So couldn't get it done. Rob calls Jack and says, "Hey, you got a killer machine shop. Make a spacer."
All right. In those days, your intake manifold and you had the spacer on, carburetor spacer on top. The height of the manifold didn't matter if it was welded, if it was the spacer was welded on. You could only run a 2-inch spacer. Us being young and just trying to get, you know what I mean, we're still licking our wounds and building cars and trying to compete. Went to the NASCAR official that was in charge of the engines and said, "Look, we can't keep up with it. be okay that instead of welding a spacer, we run a 2.5-inch spacer or a 3-inch spacer instead of a 2, instead of welding an inch and then bolting a 2 on there, right? Maintaining the right height, but just be able to bolt them on. And he said, yeah, I don't see any problem with that. I said, okay. So we had all these different cars that were all different configurations, and you put an engine in, and you're trying to get as low as you can, you this, that, and the other, and you put the spacer on that got the air cleaner up against the hood, as high as it was, and that was it. And, you know, that's what we had been running, and from the previous season even.
Now, according to Robin, they had started running this piece in the previous season with no issues during many, many inspections. Somehow, Richard Childress had found out about this carburetor spacer and believes it allows more air into the engine, creating more horsepower. NASCAR makes the call, the win stands, but issues a 46-point penalty, which equates to the number 6 car finishing as the last car on the lead lap. Jack Roush goes through the appeal process, but he doesn't take Robin Pimenton or Steve Mill with him.
You felt like you got let down by NASCAR at the time. Me personally, I mean, I was the one that talked to the official, and you know, Jack was clear on it, and we were clear on it, and, you know, you took it personally that you did something that, you know, hurt the team.
Don't understand to this day how they said you could do it. They approved it. And then after the race, they knocked you down.
Yeah. And then, you know, you go down there and you fight the appeal, and I wasn't in on the appeal, didn't know how all that was going to turn out. Jack did it, and you know, it didn't turn out like we had hoped. You know,
this part, it's a bit strange to me, because I would have at least had Robin in the room so he could say, hey, it was so and so who gave me the okay to run this piece, go penalize that jack wagon. This did not happen, and the appeal is denied. But it feels like we're missing something's out of context here. I don't know what it is. I don't know how NASCAR could say it was okay to run the part then penalize them. My best guess is they said, Robin, it's okay to run a 2-inch bolt-on spacer. Robin, instead, runs a 2.5-inch bolt-in spacer. And NASCAR says, wait a minute, that's not what we agreed to. But that does not come out in these interviews. It's like there's a question or answer missing to fill in these blanks. How could an official approve it, then later penalize you for it? Maybe we just have some CYA going on. I don't know. What I do know, it's now obvious the other competitors view Jack Roush and the number 6 team as serious contenders. Richard Childress made this clear. The fact he broke the unwritten rule of being so public about it may be in part to how Jack Roush openly questioned the inspection process of several cars during the Daytona 500. Steve Mill certainly believes, at minimum, it rubbed several people within NASCAR the wrong way, and they may have been waiting for an opportunity to send a message to the Cat in the Hat.
I thought that there was like this sort of unspoken agreement, like
you wouldn't
roll up in the middle of a tech
as an
on the opposing team and go, look at that, that's wrong.
Yeah.
Physically in the moment. Right now you might go up in the trailer and tell Buster or somebody, say, hey man, I don't think that car fits the temp.
Yeah.
You might have that conversation with them behind closed doors, but not out there in the middle of the garage pointing. And
but didn't this start with Jack doing this? I mean, I'm trying to put all this together. What I'm saying is that Jack started doing this.
Jack sitting in and watching tech at Daytona after they failed his car should have no impact on Richard Childress. Richard's not doing this in response to that.
Richard just
saw a threat
in
terms of their performance. To walk up into the garage or wherever, right, openly in the out and go, that is wrong. Look at that. Come here, guys.
I see the difference. But then if going back to your comment saying that was unfortunate and that maybe Jack just didn't understand the culture, I would assume that means that it did have some sort of ramification that maybe even put a bullseye on you guys or something. I mean, like, I think
that's true.
So maybe he didn't do exactly what Richard did, going, there it is, I told you.
Right.
But it probably didn't help any of the situations, right?
Yeah, it was, as in the words of Ernie Elliott, it's a combination of things.
What is also interesting, when Robin Pimenton was asked if he was angered by what Richard Childress had done, he said no, he was not angry. Why? Because he had done the same thing to other teams. Maybe not so public, but in private with NASCAR officials. This is how the sport polices itself. The best inspectors are the competitors. So, after Richmond, how did the rest of the season go? Dale Earnhardt holds the point lead for several races into the early part of 1990. Mark Martin does not break into the top 5 until race number 6. Race number 10, and Dale Earnhardt starts running into some issues. With a 30th place finish, followed by a 31st place finish, Mark Martin has now passed him and holds second place behind points leader Morgan Shepherd. What the? Morgan Shepherd is your points leader? Where's that? JoJo, are you playing music? Oh, I see what's going on. Yeah, Morgan Shepherd. 1990, points leader. Championship on the way. Well, his point lead lasted about as long as that skate. Mark takes the lead following race number 12 and will hold it all summer and into the fall. By race number 13, Earnhardt has dropped to fifth. But here come the plate tracks. Wins at Daytona and Talladega put Earnhardt 1 point behind the leader. Let's take a moment and appreciate Dale Earnhardt's restrictor plate game 1990. If not for the flat tire going to turn three on the final lap of the Daytona 500, Earnhardt would have swept all four restrictor plate races. That has never happened. Race number 26 at Charlotte. There is a point of contention by some in this race. After a pit stop, Earnhardt leaves pit road with no lug nuts on his left side tires. I guess he was getting an early start on No Nut November. Oh, good grief. Hey, JoJo, did I write that one as well? Really? I need to fire myself.
Wheel fell off. What? A wheel has fallen off number three and the tires rolling through turn one.
They didn't get a chance to tighten the lugs up.
Well, they did a two-tire on the right side. It probably somebody took the lifts off. They didn't know it. It's a standard deal on a pit stop.
So we got a bit of confusion on the pit stop between a four-tire and a two-tire stop. Now, Steve Mill makes reference to how NASCAR allowed the pit crew to run out on the track and put tires on the number three car instead of being carried back by a truck, which would have put them several laps down. I'm not sure if Steve is misremembering. Earnhardt did finish several laps down in 25th. The next closest competitor was 17 laps behind him. So it really had no effect on how he got his tires back on the left side. I doubt even being carried on the back of a hauler to pit road would have cost him 17 laps, dropping him to 26th, or even costing him 34 laps, dropping him to 27th. Heading into race number 28 at Phoenix, Mark Martin has a 45-point lead.
It will be just six laps of green flag racing left. Martin has his work cut out for him. So does Earnhardt and Kenny Schrader up front. Doyle Ford waving the green flag. Mark Martin wasting no time trying to go to work on Davey Allison. But there's Bill Sedgwick's car on the inside. He's trying to win a championship, too. He came in and made a pit stop. They got to dispense with some of the lap cars on the inside. Double foul restart.
And here comes Ernie Irvin. He also made a pit stop for fresh tires since Mark Martin has. Look at the heavy traffic. There's trouble up in turn four. There's a car up against the wall. It's car number 93.
Troy
Five
Beebe.
Laps to go.
Troy Beebe has tagged the wall up in turns three and four, and he gets the car fired.
No caution.
As yet, no caution flag, and that's a break for Martin. Martin is Martin now, but he's able to make his move.
He goes by the Davey Allison car, tries to go by, but there is some traffic up there. He does clear him. He's up to ninth. Now he'd be 2 points behind if the race was to end.
But here comes Ernie Irvin. Ernie Irvin on the inside, and Martin has got caught behind one of the slower cars, and Irvin is going underneath him.
So now he's back to where he was.
Exactly.
6 points.
6 points behind.
Four laps to go. They cross the line. That's five. And Martin now getting boxed in behind some slower traffic. That's Rick Wilson in front of him.
And there comes the 73 car, Bill Smith, who's trying to win a championship.
Now the back straight made the turn three. Martin has got to catch Ernie Irvin and possibly Jeff Bodine. As Irvin now just beginning to pull away a little bit, going by the Dave Marcus car.
Yeah, he's going to have a tough time passing any other car that means points for him. If that's Dave Marcus, that's not points because Dave is a couple laps down.
Boy, they are got their fist wound up tight. They are hoping and hoping and hoping that it will hold on. Earnhardt has been the dominant car here all afternoon. After the Rusty Wallace exit with the blown engine in lap 50, it has been all Dale Earnhardt and Goodrich Chevrolet. Two laps to go. Earnhardt will get the white flag next time by. If he can hold on and Martin cannot catch any other cars, Earnhardt will take the points lead. But they're battling back in the pack. Kulwicki in the car number 7. That's Rick Mast in 98 and Jeff Bodine in the Budweiser 4.
Kulwicki goes by the lap car of Derek Cope. White flag. White flag is out for our leader, Dale Earnhardt.
Final lap for Dale Earnhardt as the Goodrich Chevrolet goes hustling off into turn 1. They have got to be smiling in the Goodrich pits if they can just hold on for about 3/4 of a mile. Where is Mark Martin? There's Earnhardt. Martin, well, there he is, trying to hold on. He's still being shown in the 9th spot. Not quite going to do it as he's trying to catch Ernie Irvin.
Terry Labonte blew an engine across the start-finish line as he got the white flag.
And Dale Earnhardt will come out of turn 4 and take the checkered flag to win the Checker 500 at Earnhardt's Goodrich crew celebrating. There's Richard Childress.
Ooh, Martin crashes down in turn 1.
But they had got their checkered flag already, and he ran down there, and there was nothing but smoke and sun in front of those drivers after Terry Labonte blew, and Mark Martin was trying to pass a car for a position to get across the start-finish line and could not get it stopped as he got into a couple of people. It was from Terry Labonte's blown engine. Terry blew the engine as he crossed the start-finish line in the Skoal Classic Oldsmobile number 1 as he got the white flag.
Dale Earnhardt, who is victorious today, and Earnhardt will take the points lead.
Dale Earnhardt proceeds to go out and dominate the Phoenix race, leading 262 of 312 laps. Mark Martin would finish 10th. Even worse, the point lead he had held since race number 12, covering from June 10th all the way to November 4th, is gone. He has now dropped to 2nd, 6 points behind Dale Earnhardt. We now have our epic matchup for the final race. But hold on, there's an off week before Atlanta, which may have been the worst thing that could happen for Mark Martin and the number 6 car. They set up a test session at Atlanta, and according to Steve Mill, the number 6 team took 12 cars. That's right, 12. In an article I read, Mark Martin states he only drove 4 cars during the test, so I'm going to assume that had the others on standby, but only drove the best 4. We also have Ford stepping in, who has reached out to Jack Roush and the other Ford teams with a call to do whatever necessary to beat those Chevrolets. Davey Allison and the Robert Yates 28 car is at this test as well. Mark Martin asks and is given permission to drive the number 28 car. After running several laps, Mark brings the car in and tells his team, "I need that engine." Dale Earnhardt and the number 3 car show up, run some laps. They're 3 seconds faster than the number 6 car, which was good enough for them, so they pack up and leave the track. According to Richard Childress, there is some gamesmanship going on that day. "We went to Atlanta, and Jack was running Mark, and he was using Yates cars and engines and everything," Childress said. "We pulled in there, ran that morning, put 4 left side tires on, went out there, put up a number we knew they wasn't about to touch." Not sure if it's still true today, but back then, left side tires were much softer than the right side. Softer tires meant more grip. More grip meant higher speeds. So Earnhardt goes out and puts up this number that's not legit. The number 16, they don't know this, so they're wasting their time chasing ghosts. And to finish a statement from Richard Childress, "We were really, really fast. Then we loaded the car up at lunchtime, went on over to Alabama to go hunting," Childress said. "We just stopped in Atlanta to do a thing. We made us a few fast laps, loaded up, and left." Rusty Wallace was at this test as well. Let's see what he said. "Mark is just going crazy, Rusty Wallace," the 1989 Winston Cup champion said last week between testing sessions in Atlanta. "They got 4 or 5 different cars spread around, and they've even got a brand new car that they've never run before. Mark is hunting for something. They may be over-engineering themselves, getting too confused. But I like them both, and I hope it's a close race." And how did Earnhardt's testing go? "Earnhardt was here half a day, loaded up, and went home," Wallace said. "I'll tell you one thing, they're 2 different cats." And finally, what did Mark Martin say? "It didn't feel a whole lot different than our best car, but the stopwatch looked better," said Martin, winner of 3 races this year. "We had 4 cars there. One of them was better than the rest, and Allison's was faster. We have to take risk and find the advantage to flat out beat Dale Earnhardt. The risk of braking is a lot higher, but the car will run faster, so it's a risk we have to take at this point." and his comment on Dale Earnhardt's brief test session. They were really confident and didn't work on their stuff real hard or didn't run an abundance of laps, Martin said. For the most part, their speed was better than ours. So now, Jack Roush has a dilemma. If he asks and takes just the engine from Robert Yates, that would demoralize his own engine department. So he asks for the car, and Robert Yates, with pressure from Ford, I'm sure, agrees to let Jack Roush take the entire car.
What did he say about the car?
He said, I need that motor. Put yourself in Jack Roush's shoes. I mean, you would never want that to happen. You know what I mean? I was like, oh, boy, I don't know as I'd have said that. Yeah. But anyway, and the way it all went down was, Jack said, if you get the motor, you get the car. So, but anyway, Jack did make a statement somewhere that it wasn't about the engine. We needed the car because the Yates guys had figured out something in the steering. And that broke everybody's heart. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But you know, be honest, it would have broken everybody's heart in Livonia, including Jack's, if we had just taken the engine.
But Jack was true to form. I've heard Greg Biffle and Matt Kenseth state one thing about him. Whatever the driver or crew chief needed, a particular part or a piece of equipment that would help them win, Jack always agreed, made sure they got what they wanted.
Jack allowed the drivers to not only have an opinion about direction, but also sort of shape and steer. Had y'all in the room all the time. When there was conversations going on or discussions, you guys were always at the table.
Jack's view was, let's let the best people decide. The driver knows. The driver has an opinion. He feels like the driver knows what he needs to win. Jack ran it as me, my crew chief, and our engineer. And we were kind of in charge of our own destiny. You guys are in charge of if you think you need a drop snout car or you think you need this front suspension or this.
The best thing about driving for Jack is he'd give you whatever you wanted. If we really thought there was something that was better and we did the research and really needed it, he never, ever, ever once asked what it cost. He'd be like, okay, if that's going to make you better, go ahead and get it, you know, and he'd get it for you.
And now we arrive at Atlanta, the 1990 season finale.
We're ready to go settle this thing right now.
It's time to go racing. We're just going to stand on the gas.
Not yet.
But, Benny, the last couple of weeks, the Martin team, you wonder about them.
Boy, I tell you what, they have done more work the last 2 weeks than all year. It looks like on Tuesday after the Phoenix race, Robert Yates called Ford, is there anything I can do? They relayed that to Jack Roush. He had Robert Yates bring a car and Jake Elder to Atlanta. On Thursday, the Roush team used that car. Mark Martin loved it. And, folks, that's the car that Mark Martin's going to drive in today's final race.
Benny, I wouldn't have had the guts to go away from what got me to where they are in the championship. Be interesting to see if they made a mistake.
Then there's no doubt it's a real gamble, isn't it, Jerry Bunch?
Indeed it is, Benny Parsons. You know, what other chance do they have? I mean, given their record here, they have no other choice. But you know, as one crew member told me, desperate people do desperate things. But this ace in the hole could be their Achilles heel. Why? Because it's an unfamiliar race car. And to give you an example why it's unfamiliar, take a look at this wire right here I'm holding in my hand. It's a bypass wire that Robert Yates' racing team uses around the ignition box. When Mark Martin went out to qualify, this wire actually melted in the car and created a fire in the car. They had to go in and rewire the car. They didn't know it was there. Robert Pemberton didn't know that this wire existed, but it's something Robert Yates' team uses that they have never used. So a lot of unknowns today for Mark Martin. A different car, incredibly different design, a different race engine, and a chance to win a championship.
And Mark Martin is off the gas, coming off the second corner and going slow down the backstretch.
Very slow down the backstretch. Mark Martin, the title contender.
Fellas, is this the championship going away? Any chance at it?
Well, he's back up to speed and won't be not up to full speed, but at least gets the car going a little bit better.
Maybe he just got the car out of shape over there. I guess he just got loose over the corner. Sorry, Bob.
Well, he was definitely going slow at the point I glanced up. Let's take a look at it.
Coming off the second corner on the inside of Michael Walter, and for some reason, the car just slowed, and the 12 car almost ran in the back of it. Watch this. Wow.
Oh, boy. Boy, Mark had to turn left there and get out of his way. Let's go to John, who's with Steve Meehl. He can tell us maybe what happened.
Steve, what happened to Mark out there?
He got up under Michael and the motor cut off, so he just reached up and got it refired on the other ignition system. He said he's okay.
So he just had to change ignition system? Should be okay for him?
Yeah, he's got a switch right there. He said, well, no big deal. I said, you get loose? He said, no, motor cut off. I'm all right.
Well,
that will not mean anything for the championship. It will mean the loss of 5 points between one position and another, but he's still got a comfortable point pad on Mark Martin. Mark, meanwhile, well, what can you say about the season that this team, this driver has had? They have just been, well, great is about the only way you can say it. He led from Sears Point until just 2 weeks ago at Phoenix when he lost the points lead and came to Atlanta with a 6-point difference. But things, despite the fact that they came here and tested last week and found what they thought was going to be the car to take him to victory, it didn't happen.
Now he's going to try to get that fifth position. He was moving up on Darrell Walker there. That would be for position. He's going to try to get in.
So many interesting things have happened in this Winston Cup season as the 7 car has gotten himself ahead of the 27 with 5 laps to go. You know, you mentioned the 46 points that Martin was penalized at Richmond, but there's so many other things that you also have to look at, like the last quarter lap at Daytona.
I asked Steve Meehl about that last Tuesday. I said, what about the 46 points in Richmond? He said, that's history.
Yeah, it is.
That's old news.
You can't go back.
You can't go back.
Mark has now passed the car number 17 of Darrell Waltrip and is on the leaderboard in top 5.
Mark Martin and Darrell Waltrip battling side by side for 5th position, and Mark has it.
There's still 4 laps to go. If that 3 car can just keep running,
yep,
he's okay. But Jess will keep going.
That's all he's got to do is circle this racetrack. There's Richard Childress, his car owner.
Biting his
fingernail biting down, fellas.
Going to win the race, but he is going to win the championship if things can hold on for just 2.5 more laps.
Have Dale Jarrett, who's running there in 4th place right behind Earnhardt. If he can finish where he is, it'll be his best finish ever in Winston Cup competition. He has a couple of 5th place finishes, but not a 4th.
And you know, we talk about the Manufacturers Championship. Ford is going to win the race. They'll gain 3 points. But a Chevrolet looks like it's going to finish 2nd. They only get 3 points. It's tied. The tiebreaker, most wins, and I think it's Chevrolet 12, Ford,
yes,
11.
Right.
Wow, that's close.
The Chevrolet would win the Manufacturers Championship again. There's Morgan Shepherd, who is the leader of the race on his way to victory. His 2nd win here in Atlanta and his 3rd career Winston Cup victory.
Turn 4, white flag.
There's Earnhardt. One more lap around the 1.5-mile racetrack here at Atlanta. And the salutes begin to both Morgan Shepherd and Dale Earnhardt. Morgan Shepherd from Conover, North Carolina. Twice runner-up this year in Winston Cup competition here at Atlanta in March and at Charlotte in the 2nd race. Dale Earnhardt.
We tend to get some revisionist history around this race. The perception is that Mark Martin ran horrible that day, all because of using a Robert Yates car instead of their own, and it cost them a championship. Not really. Mark would finish 6th. It was a spot worse than his previous Atlanta race that year, but not a catastrophe that some make it out to be.
To win the championship more than 3 times, and Mark Martin is going to finish this.
Sitting solemnly and quietly on the back of the Folgers Ford that carried him so many times this year, Mark, a gallon effort.
Well, it really was. And I want to, first of all, thank all the race fans that have rallied behind us. And they've really been supportive of us this year. It's unbelievable. And obviously, Ford and Folgers and Valvoline and Jack Roush, Steve and all the guys. It's been a great year. It's tough. You know, it's a tough one to lose. We got beat by the best. And, that Dale Earnhardt's been sitting behind the wheel of the best race cars he's ever sat down in this year. He was going to be tough to tangle with. We gave him all he could stand, and we'll be stronger next year. These 4 or 6 weeks that we have that we don't have to go racing, we're going to build some good stuff, and we're going to come on strong next year.
Well, you had a great season this year, Mark, an outstanding year. To come just in 3 years from pretender to contender last year, winning that first one, to possible titleist this year. I mean, what a tremendous range you guys have come in just 3 short years.
It's been really great. All the credit, you know, goes to Jack Roush and Steve Meehl and the people that they were managed to assemble in the shops and in Michigan and in North Carolina. The guys got a lot, you know, all the guys have a lot of heart. They want to win this thing, and we will win this championship one day.
It's been said before, not all heroes wear capes. How about this? Not all champions have rings.